Making espresso taste exactly the way we want can be a challenge. Tell me if this sounds familiar. Your coffee beans are fresh and good quality. You've dialed in the recipe and you're seeing shot times of 25 to 35 seconds at 8 or 9 bar. The mousse is fine textured and persistent. All of the usual reference marks are lining up just right. Your coffee is objectively sound. But you find the flavor to be underwhelming, and that makes no sense. If you change the grind or the dose, your shot time goes off the rails and it only tastes worse. According to technical standards, it would seem that you're right in the zone and the coffee is giving you all it's got, only you're not convinced. You remember the smell when you ground it, and that persuades you that something is missing in the cup. What are we overlooking? Well, a few details, which I'm going to tackle one at a time. Let's get to the bottom of this, shall we?
Oh my God.
It's like a miracle.
It sounds so very simple. Extraction is the business of dissolving soluble solids in water. Of course, it gets complicated when we consider all of the factors that come into play. Water pressure, grit size, the dose, the contact time, ratio, and so on. On top of that, coffee itself is variable. Dense beans grown at high altitudes with plenty of shade tend to resist extraction. Low-density beans give it up a lot easier and can even be prone to over-extraction. Roasting is another influential factor. The darker we roast, the more the cellulose matrix deteriorates, making it easier for water to work its magic. And of course, the cultivar itself influences the coffee's properties. As a result of all this variability, we spend a lot of time adjusting our equipment. Coffee nerds are hardly strangers to complicated procedures and subtle concepts. But if there's one major tuning knob that many of us take for granted, it's water temperature. We tend to think of it in the context of calibrating our machinery. We set it and forget it. But it's a mistake to look for a temperature to suit your device instead of your coffee. Heat is a big deal. It amplifies the solvent activity of water. Indeed, if the water gets too hot, we'll extract unwelcome flavor compounds. I'm sure everyone has tasted over-extracted or burnt coffee. Meanwhile, cooler water retards the extraction process. When you think your coffee is underperforming as espresso, despite having nailed it technically, think about temperature as a key that can open another toolbox. Generally, for espresso, we'll look for a minimum of 88 degrees Celsius and a maximum of 95, or a minimum of 190 degrees Fahrenheit to a maximum of 203. The great thing about temperature adjustments is that they don't require changes to any other parameter. When you increase your dose, for example, you have to grind a bit coarser to keep your shot time in the zone. If you change pressure, you'll have to change your dose or your grind. But temperature has little effect on shot mechanics, at least within the range that works for brewing, although it affects flavor substantially, so if it's not part of your dialing in routine, it ought to be. The right water temperature can transform a decent shot of coffee into an excellent one. The way to approach it is first to do what you normally do to dial in an objectively or mechanically sound shot. Then begin making temperature adjustments. If you're picking up any unpleasant flavors, go lower. If the taste seems thin or bland, go hotter. You'll encounter a noticeable difference. Temperature management is a very effective tool. Now let's look at the best way to taste espresso for comparisons. Because it brings such intensity of sensation, it exhausts your palate quickly. So when you're tweaking and testing espresso, do what I do. Commit heresy. In other words, make Americanos. Judging them can tell you a lot because subtle flaws that lie hidden under those intense flavors are suddenly revealed. Here's how you do it. Use a 2-to-1 ratio, say around 60 milliliters of water for around 30 milliliters of espresso. If you do any kind of water treatment for brewing, use that same water here. And don't overheat it. You want it around 60 degrees Celsius. You can taste these samples repeatedly without exhausting your palate, and that allows you to pick out subtle flavors and minor flaws. When you get a result like beautiful pour-over with depth and complexity and real balance, the corresponding espresso will be superb. Give your palate a chance to recover and verify that by tasting a shot straight up. You'll see that I'm right. Here's another item we often overlook. Roasted coffee can be too fresh. It doesn't reach its peak flavor until 1 to 3 weeks after cooking. Chemical reactions connected with flavor development continue long after the beans are cool. Of course, the reactions go very slowly at room temperature. Also, freshly roasted beans hold more CO2, which can make your espresso mousse grainy. You'll get more foam, but it will be coarse and it won't last. Again, a week, or two, or three, depending on the coffee, will ensure that the mousse is fine-textured and persistent. You might get a thinner layer, but it will be higher quality foam, and better is better than more. Finally, I would strongly recommend looking into different brewing ratios for some really productive tweaking. We're fixed on 1 to 2 as if it were ideal, but the reasons behind it are more commercial than culinary. It became cafe canon because 1 to 2 stands up well to milk, and milk drinks are more profitable than black coffee. It's also more convenient, hence cheaper, to make double shots and split each into 2 singles when you're busy. But a single shot is not half of a double. The correct ratio is 1 to 3, so it's a completely different drink, one worth learning and enjoying in its own right. It's my preferred cup of espresso because I like it black, and 1 to 3 tastes better in that case. We see 1 to 2 on YouTube a lot because quite a few online coffee nerds come from the industry and that's what they're accustomed to. The ratio rut is another dubious product of widespread Starbuckification. If you really want to perfect your espresso, I would urge you to loosen up with your ratios. Get a hold of one of those dainty little 8-gram baskets, the kind many of us neglected to buy because they look like they're for girls. Only they're not. My sole complaint with the robot is that it hasn't got one. Otherwise, I would make a proper single for you right now and explain it in lavish detail and insist that you try it. In my opinion, the classic single is the best thing you can get out of an espresso maker, perhaps because with a 1-to-3 ratio, it's similar to mocha pot coffee made according to my voodoo method. I actually prefer the flavor of my own mocha pot coffee to a double shot of espresso. The only thing that beats it is a classic single. I've posted my preferred recipe for it in the description, so you can copy and paste and start tweaking. And by all means, share your experiences and variations in the comments. Well, that's about all for today. Coming up, I've got a short video surprise, then the AeroPress hack that I've been promising, and then a review of what I believe to be the finest hand grinder for the money that you can get. So keep in touch. Cheers!